a series of Advent sermons that have been focusing on the parable of the prodigal son. Remember that this is one of three parables in a row that Jesus tells to a group of religious leaders who were grumbling about how willingly Jesus was receiving sinners. Of course, all three parables were about how much heaven rejoices when lost sinners are found. So these religious leaders who were grumbling are much like the older brother that we're going to see in our scripture this morning. So it turns out that this parable is not just a lesson for prodigal sons. It's also for older brothers who sometimes simply deserve God's grace. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we ask that just as your Holy Spirit inspired the writing of this scripture this morning, so you would inspire us and draw us more closely to our Savior Jesus Christ and transform us more into his image. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. We're picking up the story of the prodigal son in verse 25 of Luke chapter 15. It says, "Now his older son, the father's older son, was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. The servant said to him, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has received him back safe and sound.' But the older brother was angry and refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him, but he answered his father, 'Look, these many years I have served you, and I never disobeyed your command. Yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him.'" This is the word of the Lord. All we know about the older brother so far in this story is that he has already received his share of the inheritance. Remember that when the younger brother came up to his dad and asked for the inheritance, the father divided it up between both of them. And so the older brother received what was his, which traditionally would have been the larger portion, about two-thirds of the family estate. And ever since his younger brother had sold his share of the inheritance and made a lot of money and gone off into this faraway country, the older brother has been working hard at home, taking care of the family property, which is now his. That's exactly where we find him in the beginning of our text this morning, hard at work in the field. Older brothers, and of course older sisters as well, can always be found in the field. These are the people who work very, very hard, and they strive to make good choices in their lives. And they always have goals, and they have plans to meet those goals. They try to do everything well. They even fail well. Because for them, failure is just a chance to work even harder so that they can succeed the next time. This is part of what older brothers and sisters are so proud of, and it's part of why we admire them. Well, after putting in another hard day's work managing his inheritance, the older brother came back to the house, and he heard music and dancing in the house. And this was not normal. This was way more excitement than he is used to having in what is now his house. And so when he gets back to the house, he's confused, and he asks one of the young servants, he says, what's going on? Why is there music and dancing? And he tells him, "Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fattened calf, this special calf that was set aside for religious holidays. The father has killed it to make a feast to celebrate the brother's return. And so the prodigal son has come home." As a camper at Calvin Crest when I was growing up, I sometimes felt a little bit left out during the Wednesday night campfires. That's because Wednesday night was the night when typically the campers would be invited to come forward and make a commitment to follow Jesus. They had different ways of doing this. One of my favorites was when the campers would come over and they would take a pine cone out of the basket and then they would walk over to the campfire and they'd throw it into the fire. It was a way of representing the old sins and the old self that we throw into the fire so that God's love can consume us and wipe away our old life and make us new. It was a powerful metaphor. And that campfire was always a great celebration for lost children coming home. I threw a lot of pine cones into those fires. But every time I did, I felt a little bit like a fraud because the truth was, I was already trying to follow Jesus. I grew up in a church. I'd spent my whole life trying to do that. My new life in Christ looked a lot like my old life in Christ. And quite frankly, my sins were boring. The truth was, I was an older brother. And I threw those pine cones into the fire because otherwise it seemed like nobody was about to throw a party for my story. And some of you know exactly what I'm talking about. You've worked hard at being a good Christian your whole life, only to discover sometimes that the biggest parties are not thrown for you but for the prodigals when they come home. You know what it feels like to be a little bit jealous of someone else's dramatic conversion experience. You know what it feels like to be a little bit envious of the certainty and the conviction that recent converts sometimes have in their faith. And the fact that God's grace seems so palpable in their lives. You want that. And you say to yourself, I've lived in my Father's house my whole life. So why is it that I suddenly feel like I'm the one on the outside? But when the older brother learned of the reason for the celebration, Jesus tells us that he became angry, and he refused to go inside. So the one who was the insider suddenly found himself on the outside. That's what anger always does. Anger keeps you outside the party. Your life could be filled to the brim with wonderful reasons to be joyful, but if you are angry about so much as one small thing, it will keep you outside of that joy. Watching everybody else's happiness through the window, which of course just makes you angry. This is true, by the way, even when you are right. The older brother had a perfectly good reason to be angry, just like you have a good reason to be angry when somebody says something hurtful to you, or when you get blamed for something that wasn't your fault, or when a loved one in your life dies when they were way too young, and you're angry, and you have good reason to be angry, but anger is still anger, and a good reason is not enough to bring you inside where it's joyful. That's why the Bible warns us not to let the sun go down on our anger. You cannot enter fully into joy until you let go fully of your anger. Well, the reason for the older brother's anger was pretty simple. His father was not being fair. When his father finally came outside to get him, he told him as much, and he said, "Look," he doesn't even call him father, which was culturally appropriate. He just says, "Look, these many years I have served you and I never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me so much as a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours," see what the anger is doing to him? He doesn't even call him his brother. This son of yours, it's keeping him outside the family. "When this son of yours came who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him." The father welcomed the prodigal son home without any punishment, without any accountability, and with a huge party. The prodigal got what the older brother deserved, and it wasn't fair. And that's the point. It's not fair. That's because this is not a parable about fairness. This is a parable about grace. I don't know if you knew this, but the whole reason the Apostle Paul wrote his letter to the Romans was so that he could defend his gospel, his good news about Jesus Christ, so that he could defend it to the Jews who thought it was unfair for God to offer salvation free of charge through the blood of Christ. And it makes sense. I mean, the Jews were the people who for thousands of years had been worshiping this God and knew the rules, they knew the laws, they obeyed their whole lives for generations. If anyone deserved God's salvation through Christ, it was the Jews. And yet all of a sudden, people from every nation, every language, were coming into the family with nothing more than a confession, "I believe in Jesus." It wasn't fair. God's grace is never fair. If it were fair, then all of us would get what we deserve. And trust me, that's the last thing you ever want from God. God's grace does not give us what we deserve. If it did, it wouldn't be grace. I'm struck by the older brother's comment that he had served his father for many years. The word for served there is the same as the word for slave. He literally says, "I have slaved for you all of these years, my whole life." Now this presents an interesting twist in the story. As you see, the prodigal came home hoping to work as a slave. That's the best he could hope for, only to find that he was welcomed back as a son in his father's arms. Whereas the older brother had been working hard to preserve his status as a son, only to find that all along he had just been working like a slave. That's because he had missed the point of hard work. I remember as a kid going down to prune my grandpa's peach trees with my brother every winter during Christmas break. There were some days when I complained about the fact that I had to spend the mornings of my Christmas vacation, my precious vacation, walking down the street and pruning these peach trees and doing this work. But I was a good kid and I was a good grandson. I wanted to make sure I preserved that reputation, and so I would go down with my brother in the fog and I would do my duty and prune those peach trees. But on those days, there was no joy in that work. Now I look back and I realize that the real joy of pruning those peach trees was just to spend time in the orchard with my grandpa. Turns out that was his joy too. The point of hard work is not to prove something or to earn something or to get what we think we deserve. The point is just to be with the Father. When your work becomes just a way to earn a paycheck, or just a way to win approval, or fish for compliments, all the joy is going to leak out of it, and you'll just end up working like a slave. Adam and Eve were not told to work the garden so that all the animals would think they were great gardeners. They were told to work the garden because that was the best way to spend time with their Creator. That was the point. Being in God's presence is the real joy, the only joy, in all of our work. Turns out that's the real joy for God as well. In the parable, the Father's desire is not just to have hard workers, but to spend time with His children. That's why He welcomed His prodigal son home with such a huge party. And that's why He also came outside to plead with the older brother to come in. You see, the party is for both sons. Because now the whole family is back together again. The party is something that neither of them deserve. Because it has nothing to do with being a reward for what they have done. It's a celebration of being together as a family. And only grace puts families back together. Some of you are here this morning feeling like maybe you've been on the outside for a while now, maybe even years. It might be your anger over something in the past. It might be your frustration that God doesn't seem to answer your prayers and doesn't even seem real sometimes. Maybe you're envious of the way that God seems to show up in other people's lives, but he seems painfully absent from yours. Whatever the reason, one thing is certainly true. The Father wants you to come inside. You don't have to throw another pine cone into the fire. You don't have to fake a dramatic conversion experience to go into the party. All you have to do is give up thinking that the party has anything to do with what you deserve or how good you've been your whole life. And then, entering this joyful celebration will be as easy as just stepping through the front door. As we will see tomorrow night at our Christmas Eve service, that is exactly what the Father is begging you to do this Christmas. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.